This talk is going to be a whirlwind tour of a bunch of exciting tooling, really what the community has standardized upon over the last 2 years. There's nothing in this that is specific to GraphQL, the way we do things. It's really the community tooling. My name is Søren Palmer-Schmidt. I work at GraphQL in Berlin. We co-organized the conference that Gerard mentioned, GraphQL Europe. The first thing I'll talk about is GraphQL config. And GraphQL config is a common standard for configuring GraphQL projects, and it's about the GraphQL CLI. This is really the one CLI tool that ties everything together. Then there's the GraphQL Playground, which is an interactive environment to work with GraphQL queries. So you probably all know GraphQL, and if GraphQL is Notepad, then this is Visual Studio Code or something like that. Then we have GraphQL Binding, which is a way to expose existing GraphQL APIs and work with them in your native language. You can kind of think of it as SDKs for GraphQL APIs. Then there's Grams, which is a really interesting approach created by IBM. So they have this issue that they have a bunch of different microservices that all expose GraphQL, and they see them as data services, and they want to combine them and share them internally. So that's what Grams is about. GraphQL Import is similar to a modular system. When you're writing code, you want to modularize your code. And that's the same concept for GraphQL schemas. Your schemas end up being very long and you want to modularize them. Then Apollo tracing is really exciting when you're operating GraphQL at scale. You need to have performance insights. And Apollo has done a great job of creating a standard around this and creating a bunch of tooling that makes it easy to dig into the performance of particular parts of your GraphQL schema. GraphQL Yoga is a nice little server framework that makes it super easy to get started building GraphQL servers. So let's dive right in. First, GraphQL config. So what is the problem? Our problem is that development tools require configuration. All development tools require configuration. As I said, GraphQL is awesome for creating development tools, so we have a lot of configuration. That's annoying. This is a configuration file for an IntelliJ plugin for GraphQL. This is a different configuration file for Visual Studio plugin. This is a configuration file for a Webpack-based tool. All of these configuration files are different, but they all contain basically the same information. But what is the issue when all of these configurations are different? Well, it's the same issue you have with REST APIs or something like that. They're not standardized, so you cannot really create tooling around it. But what if we could come up with a common way to define all the information we need for GraphQL tools? Then we could all work from the same common base. So that is what we have done. One format to rule them all. There's a joke in there around something, I'm not quite sure. So the GraphQL config specification is developed by GraphQL and Facebook in combination. So we took all the requirements we had at GraphQL. We talked with the guys from Facebook. We found all the requirements they had, went back and forth over a year-long period, and came up with this common format that would enable us to just load this piece of configuration, share it with the entire team, and work with all kinds of tooling. So that's worth checking out. It has broad support, and then it has an extension architecture, which is really nice. GraphQL CLI. So one problem we have is we have a bunch of tools. And how do we work with all of this? How do we tie it together? We create a GraphQL CLI that is the foundation for all your development tools. So GraphQL CLI, it started with this issue that you often need to download the schema of a GraphQL endpoint. For example, if you've worked with Relay, you know that you need a schema locally for the Relay compiler to work. So in the beginning, Relay was shipping a little shell script to do this. And a bunch of other tooling needs this ability. So that's the first thing the GraphQL CLI does. But then the community started building more and more functionality into it. So now you can diff schemas. You can run queries directly from a GraphQL file against an endpoint. You can use this to interactively set up a GraphQL config file. And this CLI also has plugins. I don't know if you saw last year the team from APIs Guru, they created this GraphQL Voyager that can visually explore a GraphQL schema. Really exciting. That works with the GraphQL CLI. You can do code generation using Apollo Code Gen. You can create bindings that we'll talk about more in a little bit. In the GraphQL Playground, how many of you have used GraphQL? Most of you. How many have seen the GraphQL Playground? Some of you. That's really nice. So I'm a little saddened whenever I talk to people who use the GraphQL and they don't know about GraphQL Playground, because GraphQL is nice, but you want something more. This is GraphQL. It's been like this for a year. It works, but it's too limited. So what is the solution? Add more buttons, of course. This is very dark. Can you see what is on the screen? Nah, okay. That sucks. This is the playground. I'll just walk through a bunch of features. The playground has tabs built in. That's really nice, so you don't lose your context. You can work many different queries. You can do a mutation in one tab, do a query in the other tab, and keep your state. It has built-in subscriptions, which is also really nice when you're building your server and you need to debug what is going on. So you can have one tab where you have a live subscription running, you can have another tab where you do a mutation, and you can see your results pop up in real time as something is happening in the backend. That was better, thank you. And you can share your queries. So it connects to a cloud service, and you can, when you've come up with this crazy thing and maybe you found an issue, it's slow or it behaves in a certain way, you can just click Share Playground, send a link to your colleague, and they can instantly look into what is going on. This is a really nice collaboration tool. And it has built-in support for Apollo tracing. We'll talk more about how that works later. But what it does, you have a query like this. You create draft, you give it some arguments, you then query something from the selection set. You get a result back. But the thing about GraphQL is you get the entire result back in one time. So all you see is that the entire thing took like 600 milliseconds. You don't know what was actually slow. What you can do is you can try to remove some of these fields just to see if it gets faster. That's not a good idea. So what you want instead is you want introspection capabilities into the performance of your API. So this one tells you that the overall request took 84 milliseconds, then create draft. It's a top block that took 61 milliseconds. And of this, apparently, getting the ID took 32 microseconds and no time at all. And then the response getting back to you took 18 milliseconds. When you have a more complex query, this becomes really useful. And there's also a standalone desktop app. So you don't need to embed it in a browser if you don't want to. You can just use the desktop app. And the desktop app, of course, works together with GraphQL config. So you can open a config file with this thing and it'll pop up and show you all the endpoints you have configured, injecting the authorization variables you need to connect. So that's a great example of how all of these tools in the ecosystem actually play together. GraphQL binding. So what is the problem? The problem is you're writing a GraphQL server and implementing the solvers is hard. That's the hard part about implementing a GraphQL server. How many of you have written your own GraphQL server? Okay, 20%, that's cool. So for this example, we are writing the GraphQL server in the middle. We have a client, and then we have a GraphQL microservice. That means basically a service that exposes some of your data, but instead of using Thrift or REST or something, it exposes it over GraphQL. This is the modern world we're living in. Everything is GraphQL. Is this large enough to be read from the back? Almost, okay. So on the left server, on the left side, this is the GraphQL server we want to implement. We want to implement one query called My Spaces, My Workspaces, and people should be able to query the name and the slog of a workspace. Then this is our GraphQL microservice. And of course, it doesn't map directly. You cannot just call My Workspaces. This thing doesn't know about users. It has no idea. So what you can do over here is you can call workspaces by user. You can provide a user ID and then query, for example, the name and the slug. Now our job is to create the GraphQL server in the middle that maps these two things. So we can do that by hand. We can implement a resolver for my workspaces. In the beginning of the resolver, we get the current user for the context, we use a session token or something. And then we start writing the query that we want to send to the backend data microservice. We want to query workspace by user, put in the user ID, we do some string concatenation. Doesn't really feel nice, but it works. And then we're just doing a normal fetch against the endpoint. We could use Apollo Link or something more fancy, but we can just do a fetch. So now, what happens when the user starts to change their query? They want to query more data, more fields. The microservice already exposes those fields, so you can just extend the query you're doing in code. You see, here we are hard coding what the data we want to query from the backend service. This becomes a problem, because what if they don't just want to query some of these simple scalar fields? They want to follow relations and be more crazy. Your user wants to be able to query members and their names and their actions. That's an entire net of data you can query. And if you try to put this into your hard-coded query, then you end up querying this data all the time. And you don't want that, because that can be slow and often you don't need it. So then you get into this position where you start inspecting the incoming query and you try to construct this in a smart way. And luckily, other people have figured out this is the thing we want to do. So Apollo created the entire schema stitching concept. That's the underlying machinery that can do this for us. So instead of constructing this thing manually, we can use schema stitching to inspect the incoming query and construct this selection set automatically. That's a great blog post that my colleague wrote about schema stitching, explaining how all of this works in great detail. I'll put the link, share the slides afterwards if you want to dive into that. And now we come to GraphQL bindings. So GraphQL bindings uses schema stitching under the hood and creates this model that looks much more like using an SDK. So bindings are like an automatically generated library that works with a specific GraphQL service, and you can use it from your language. It ties directly into the features of your programming language. So in this case, we're using JavaScript. We're using TypeScript. So you can traverse down the database query. Workspace by ID is a field that is there. You can use your IDE to autocomplete. Instead of passing in a string, you are passing in an object. The object can be typed. You can get IDE warnings if you don't do this correct, if you have a spelling mistake. So this becomes much more like working with an actual SDK in your IDE. So a GraphQL binding lets you reuse a part of an existing GraphQL API inside your new GraphQL API. It maps the capabilities of your API to your programming language. It allows you to use proper error handling, try catch all of this stuff, instead of inspecting HTTP error messages. And yeah, you can think of it as an SDK. And there are two ways to generate these bindings. There are dynamic bindings and static bindings. And static bindings is what I'm most excited about. It is where you, let's say you are in a team, and one team is exposing this microservice, the other team is supposed to consume it. The team exposing this data microservice would then generate these bindings, and the other teams can then use them. And you get all of these benefits. If you do dynamic data binding instead, then you still have this ability to write very little code and think of it as an SDK, but you do not have auto-completion in the IDE. You do not have these same capabilities. Johannes' talk will give a demo of how to use all of this in practice. The next big thing, grams from IBM. This is a similar idea. So IBM, they have this problem that they have tons and tons of microservices. And putting this into a world of GraphQL turned out to be complicated for them. They needed a solution. They needed a common way to expose these microservices so that other teams could use them. So they came up with grams, and grams is a way to define, again, one specific data service and share it with the other teams. So it contains a namespace. So if you have ever tried to build larger GraphQL APIs, you know that there is this, especially for mutations, there's one global namespace. So what IBM came up with to be able to work with this in a larger context is that they prefix everything, and then for each of these services, you have to explicitly define a namespace. This is really relevant when you work on larger systems, not just in small teams that can figure it all out by talking. Then you define the types of your schema, a context, and your resolvers. And the main innovation here is that because this is in a standardized format, you can create tooling around it, which is really, really nice and allow larger teams to work together. The next tool is GraphQL import. So import, I motivated that a little bit in the beginning. You have this issue that when your schemas become really large, your GraphQL schemas, it becomes difficult to work with them. Just the same as when you're writing lots and lots of code in one file, eventually it becomes difficult to work with. You don't want that. You want to split it up. So how do you do that? As a small schema, as a schema after I worked for a few hours, it becomes unmaintainable. You want to split up your schema. You want to have type A in one file, type B, and type C in different files, and they're referencing each other. So type A have a reference to B, it's over here, B references C, it's over here. So traditionally what we have done is we've just tried to concatenate all of these files together, create some simple system to do that. And everybody has done this in their own way. But there are a bunch of pitfalls to that because you have this recursive lookup that ends up just, you have combinatorial explosion of you put all of the stuff together, then you need to filter it out again. So GraphQL import is a little library that handles all of that for you. It just goes through a file, it says what is referenced, okay, let's get these files, anything referenced from there, okay, if there are cyclic dependencies, let's just make sure it's not a problem. So GraphQL import is really only about the schema. It's not about queries or implementation or resolvers or anything like that, it's just the schemas. How many of you are familiar with this syntax for GraphQL schemas? It's what's called the SDL, the schema definition language. So GraphQL has always had this introspection query where you can run a query against a live endpoint and you get all the information about everything, but it's very verbose. It's not nice to work with as a human at all. And turns out it's also not necessarily so nice to work with for tools. So now the community is really standardizing on this much simpler syntax to define schemas and define the capabilities of a GraphQL API. If you just do import schema on a.graphql, it will go out, traverse all the other files, and combine them all together in one resulting file. Apollo tracing. Let's dive a little bit deeper into how does this actually work and what does it give you. Our problem is we're lacking performance insights. We need to know what is going on at runtime. The solution, industry standard performance tracing. So this on the left is a simple query. You're querying the hero, you're getting name, friends, and the name of the friends. And what do you get back? Of course, you get your normal data, hero, name, friends, name. But then GraphQL has this allowance for putting in an extensions field, where the specification basically says put in there whatever you want to. There's no standard or no documentation for that. It's free for all. So that's what Apollo standardized. Let's have a tracing top-level field in extensions and put a lot of information in there. Start time, end time, duration. But when we go down a little bit, it becomes more interesting. Because now you get the specific resolvers. So there's a path. Hero, that's the top level. What is it? It's a query. How much time did it take? How far into the entire execution was it? And if you go deeper, the path just lists out all this, all the leaf fields with this information. And this is already great, because if you just enable this, then you can have a look at it as a developer, and you can see what is slow and what is fast. But because this is a standardized thing, we can now create tooling around it. Like I showed you before, it's built into the playground. So you can just click on tracing and have this thing. And if your server supports tracing, which is really easy to do because it's an open standard and there are libraries for most server implementations, you basically just need to install tracing. Then it hooks in and enables this when you activate it. Then you get this ability to see exactly what is slow. It's quite surprising to see when you have this in production what it is that turns out to be slow. You have like a weird hashing function or something. And then Apollo has built this big commercial thing around it called Engine that allows you to track this in real time for all your queries and aggregate it all together. I've also talked to many other companies that are building stuff like this internally on the same standard. But the fact that there is a common standard is really, really nice. GraphQL Yoga. GraphQL Yoga is the easiest way to get started building a GraphQL server. So for all of you who had not built a GraphQL server and maybe you want to just play around, spend an afternoon, check out GraphQL Yoga to get started using Apollo server. Apollo server is already much nicer to use than using GraphQL Express, but there's still a bunch of stuff you have to combine to get the first thing running. And when you're just starting out, you don't really care so much. So this is a Yoga example. It just takes all of these common things you need to do anyway, abstracts it away, and let you focus on defining your schema and your resolvers, the stuff that actually matters for implementing a GraphQL server. And then because of it's this shared thing that just works, it also just pulls a bunch of stuff in that you probably want. So of course it's completely GraphQL spec compliant. It supports file uploads. File uploads is this thing that has been going back and forth in the community a long time. How should we actually support file uploads together with GraphQL queries? Relay did it in one way, and then Apollo wanted to also do it. But now we have something that actually works across, and Yoga just supports that out of the box. Supports GraphQL subscriptions, TypeScript, bindings. How many of you have used TypeScript? Most of you. How about Flow? Almost as many, okay. It comes with the playground, it's exposed over HTTP. Of course, you can extend it with normal Express middlewares. It enables Apollo tracing out of the box. It runs anywhere, so you can deploy it on Now or Lambda. Something like that is really, really nice to just get started super easy. Now, especially, is really easy if you just want to deploy something quickly. That was the whirlwind tour. GraphQL config, the shared configuration for all GraphQL tools, especially client-side development tools. The GraphQL CLI, that is the one CLI you can use to basically drive most of your daily workflows. The GraphQL Playground, if you're using GraphQL, check out Playground. It's really, really nice. GraphQL binding, when you're implementing an architecture where you have multiple layers of GraphQL APIs, or if you want to connect to some existing GraphQL APIs, there are also bindings for the GitHub API, for example. So this is really a thing that is growing in the community. We are creating bindings for all of these different APIs, public APIs, but also for internal APIs. Check out Grams if you are interested in how big organizations are tackling this. I think bindings is a little more lightweight, so I think this is going to have a broader appeal, but check out Grams if you're interested. There's also the last episode of the GraphQL Radio had the creator of Grams on. It was super interesting to just hear all the issues that pop up in a large organization and how they tackle them. GraphQL Import, that is just the way we now modularize our schema files. Apollo Tracing, just having that by default, so you can, whenever you see something is slow, you can just enable a header and just see what is going on. That's really nice. And GraphQL Yoga, the easiest way to get started with writing your own GraphQL server. I want to just plug a few resources. The GraphQL Europe conference. I went to the summer conference in San Francisco. I went to GraphQL Europe last year. GraphQL Europe is every bit as good as the summit, so really consider going there. It's many of the same speakers. Lee Byron was there last year. He'll probably show up again this year. GraphQL Radio is a regular podcast about GraphQL, talking to people who are really driving the community forward. So if you want to keep up, that's a really great way. Then GraphQL Weekly is a super low head, just like a weekly newsletter that shows all the new stuff that is going on. Thanks for listening.